to redeem that box.
That's right.
Get rid of the election purple.
Turn the light.
Praise God. Man, the guys that we've got here, we have such a gifted crew. Men and women that are volunteering their time and serving this community. I mean, just incredible things.
If we get lights back up here, I'll have to our seat.
I know.
Scott's got a little more. Because that has a new story, probably. But yeah, let's get the lights back on. So the guys that we've got here, Nate, Scott, it's funny when I say my boy Nate, it's like everybody kind of calls him that because he's so pivotal in so many people's stories. He's here. He's always like, my boy, oh, Nate's my boy, Nate's my boy, everybody I talk to, Nate's my boy. Because, man, the dude gets that the life of recovery comes in relationship. And that sincerely you can build something real with somebody before you can have any sort of influence or speak in any part of their life. And the example that Scott and Joe and that Nate have laid out for me that I've heard from consistently is that relationship element. If you want to really recover life, you really want to transition successfully back in the world here, they've shown so much of it comes from the relationships you build, the people you walk with. It's huge. It's huge. And I don't know, I mean, most of you guys probably do know the 7x7 language, that's scriptural, right? It comes from Matthew 18, where Peter says, how many times should I forgive my brother as many as 7 times? And Jesus says, not 7 times, 70 times 7. And he gives a parable about the power of forgiveness. Forgiveness in our faith, guys, is huge. Forgiveness is the reason that many, most, or all of us are here.
Right?
Yeah, Jesus, his life, his death, and resurrection is the reason we have this forgiveness, this gift that we can live a life that really is all about freedom. Right? We're big on freedom. We have life recovery, 7x7, the whole project, rescuing and serving people who have been rescued from human trafficking. Those two ministries deal heavily with freedom. Giving people real freedom. And Jesus talked about that a lot. Jesus in Luke 4 said, even his mission statement, the reason he's here, that he's been anointed to give good news to the poor, to bring liberty to the captives, to bring sight to the blind, and to bring freedom to those who have been in bondage and proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. Liberty, sight, freedom. That's why Jesus came. And another reason Jesus came, that with freedom, in order to get freedom, you must be forgiven. Right? So Jesus' whole ministry was built in a way that he lived a perfect life and gave us a perfect example on how God interacts with humanity. Right? You say Jesus is perfect theology because Jesus is God perfectly here on earth in the form of a man. And in the way he interacts with those who are obsessed with religion, those who are obsessed with money, those who are prostitutes, who are addicts in all different sorts of ways, Jesus says, this is the way we interact with them as followers of Jesus and as Jesus. This is how you interact with those people. And he showed us what perfect love on display looks like. And his perfect life, what did it get him to? After 33 years of life, he ended up being put to death for the way that he radically loved people. Not only put to death, but put to death by the chosen people of God.
Right?
Religious leaders of his, and following him, they said, they're the ones that put him to death. And it's that in that. It's the fact that Jesus died, and with him, our sin was buried. Right? In the most terrible moment in history, the chosen people of God put God to death. Torture him and crucify him, the ugliest, most painful death possible. That ugly moment in history became the most poetic moment in history. Right? God redeems the ugly, and that's a perfect example right there. Because Jesus rose to new life. Right? Defeating sin, defeating the devil, defeating his demons, and even defeating death. Rose to new life so that we, as his followers, may rise to new life with him. Right? God loved us so much that he sent his son here that everyone who puts their faith in Jesus will not perish but have eternal life. That's the perfect plan of forgiveness that Jesus laid out for us. He gave us a brand new opportunity, a brand new freedom, a brand new identity that as followers of Jesus Christ, we are co-heirs with Jesus. We are adopted as sons and daughters into the royal family of the Creator of the universe. Not a bad gift. What'd you do to earn it? Jesus, he died for his enemies, as Romans says. Christ died for the ungodly. Christ died for those who are still sinners. Christ gave his life up for his enemies. That's just crazy. And that sort of forgiveness is what Jesus says when he goes, hey, this is the Great Commission. This is what I want you guys to do. Go and make disciples like I've made disciples. Go love people like I've loved people. Go teach them what I've taught you. Walk like I walked. And of course, Jesus says, people will come after me. Things will be done after me that are even greater than the things I've done. He gave us a mission, right? He says, you have been forgiven. You have been set free. You have been given this new identity and a new life that you now get to walk in freedom. You get to walk in perfect relationship. He said, it's even good that I'm going away because you're going to get the Holy Spirit. He's going to come and live inside of you. So there's not just going to be one of you, but every single individual gets me inside of them. The power that conquered the grave now lives inside of you. This is the walk that we get now. Perfect freedom, perfect forgiveness. And guys, the more deeply we understand forgiveness, the more that we study into who Jesus was and what Jesus did and what Jesus conquered and who we are in him, the more we understand that he gave us a mission to live the way he lived in forgiveness. Forgiveness is pivotal. Jesus talks about it all the time. We talk about it a lot here. Jesus talked about it all the time. We continue to bring it back up because he forgave us, gave us this new identity. We now get to walk in freedom. And he says, now you go and forgive. Now you go and set other people free. You partner with me and let's do this together. I can go all over for this, but there's a couple that I feel like God wants me to go to. First of all, the Lord's Prayer. I've said some of this before, some of it might be repeated if you've been here a long time, but it's powerful, real stuff. Jesus said, let me teach you how to pray. I want that lesson, right? As soon as I hear Jesus say, let me show you how to pray. Because I hear pretty often in the scriptures, pray ceaselessly. Never stop praying. Always come back to prayer. And so, anytime anybody brings it up in a meeting that happened just this last week, I think we should pray more. I hear more in prayer time. And I made the joke, like, I think we should pray less. That's never the thing that gets brought up. You can't say, no, I think there's always more opportunity for prayer, right? You can always go more deeply into it, praise God. So Jesus says, let me teach you how to do that thing you're never supposed to stop doing. Cool, I want to listen to you, Jesus. And what he does is he says this, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our debts as we have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. Matthew 6. Jesus says, let me teach you to pray. This thing that you're supposed to do ceaselessly. Let me teach you how to do it. Maybe it's just the preacher in me that wants to go a little bit longer, wants a little bit more information, wants to dig into something, but he gave me about 50 words. I talk fast. I can get through 50 words in 15, 20 seconds, easy. Even if I'm trying to slow down. This is all you're going to give me, Jesus, okay? I want more than that, personally. You're going to teach me how to pray. Let's take a couple weeks and go into this thing. Don't just give me 50 words. I want more. For me, when I look at that prayer, there's a lot of things I want to know more about. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. All praise be to God, right? All glory be to God. This one's big for me. Your kingdom come, your will be done, here in Muskegon, here on earth as it is in heaven. Yes.
Right.
What is it like in heaven? Give me some more on that, Jesus. Give me some further explanation. What does your will and your kingdom look like right now there, and how can I partner with you in bringing that here? Amen. That's how your will be done, your kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. Can you give me more? explanation on. Give us this day our daily bread. That, there's a lot deeper you can go with that. Is that physical bread? Is that collecting you as my daily bread, getting along with you? How, which way he wants to go with that? Jesus does give further explanation after this prayer. He does further explain just one of his points, and it's not any of those three that I just brought up. It's actually the one that follows those three that says, forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors. Jesus decides to give more explanation. Just an extra 30 words I counted. Just a little bit more explanation on forgiveness.
Extra 30 words.
Jesus says, for if you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive yours. Yeah, That's big. When Jesus says this is how you should pray, God, forgive me the way I forgive others. That means the way that you forgive others is the way that he will forgive you. Jesus says in the chapter before this in Matthew 5, verse 7, blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. The flip side of that is not blessed are the merciless, right? For you will not receive mercy, because the way that you forgive, the way that you show mercy, shows really whether or not you understand what forgiveness is and how he forgave you. But it shows if you can't forgive others, then the forgiveness here isn't happening. Really, you probably don't even understand what happened here. That's heavy. Blessed are the merciful, they shall receive mercy. God, forgive me the way I forgive those who have sinned against me. Because, guys, when we understand what we've been forgiven of, remember when we went back and said what Jesus did for us, the way he conquered sin, death, the devil, his demons, rose in new life victoriously over them, said, all authority in heaven and earth is now mine. That means he's got none of it. I have all of it. I'm telling you to go. I'm telling you to go love, to go forgive, to go teach the way that I taught. He says, the forgiveness that I have put on display for you, salvation that I've made available to you, freedom that you all now get to walk in, go make it available for others. And if you can't do that, I don't know if you really understand what's been given to you. Because when we forgive, when we walk in forgiveness, when we search out and seek after reconciliation, when we put our efforts and our time into peacemaking, it says that's when we look like Jesus. Just two verses later, after the merciful scripture, it says, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will look like their dad. Right? Blessed are those who make peace. Not just keep the peace. Not just roll over, but who make peace. Who enter into the messy parts of a relationship, understanding there's not going to be a lot of earthly reward for this trial you're about to enter into. You're only making peace because he told you to. It's not going to be a real joyful experience coming here. It's difficult. But it says those who make peace look like their daddy. In verse 44, the same chapter, Matthew 5:44. But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be sons of your Father who is in heaven. Love your enemies, pray for your enemies, because then you're going to look like your dad. We make peace. We are merciful. We are forgiven. We bring freedom. 2 Corinthians 5, one of my favorite passages. I probably say that every week about something. I think I can use laugh. I do say it. One of my favorite passages, chapter 5, verse 17 of 2 Corinthians. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away, it's gone. Behold, the new has come. And all this is from God, who through Christ reconciled us to himself and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. Through Christ, he reconciled us. That really means like paying off a debt, taking this assortment of coins and paying for different assortment of coins that equals the same thing. confused. I'm trying to study Hebrew, that's all I ever got. But I know in Romans 8 it says that the wages of sin is death. The payment that you receive, just like you get payment from working a job, the payment that you receive from sinning is death. That's what you've earned. That's your paycheck. But the gift of God is eternal life, salvation through Christ Jesus our Lord. So sin, if you sin, your payment is death. Who has sinned? Everybody. Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Perfect gift of God is salvation through Christ Jesus our Lord. That's what it says. So here, I have this is from God who through Christ reconciled us to himself, made that payment, switched it around. So I'm going to make the payment equal now. I'm going to exchange your death for actually brand new life. Not just life, but the grace on top of it. Let me read the verse. Preach before I get to it again. All this is from God, who through Christ reconciled us to himself and then also gave us the ministry of reconciliation. You go reconcile and I reconcile. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting to us the message of reconciliation. Therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ. Who knows what an ambassador is? Bill, what's an ambassador?
A representative.
Yeah? Is that it? A representative. Okay, so there's a king, and he sends his ambassador to a foreign land to represent his words, his opinions, and his influence. That his commands go just as the king's go. Right? In this case, our king is in heaven, and we are his ambassadors in this foreign land that is planet Earth. In this reality, we are his ambassadors. We represent the king. We rule as the king. Our voice carries the same influence that the king's does. We represent the king here. Therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ, making his appeal through us. We implore you on behalf of Christ to be reconciled to God. For our sake, he, God, made him who knew no sin, Jesus, to be sin. Jesus took on the sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. The sins on us and in us, he made him who knew no sin, Jesus, to take all of that sin, put it on him, and then gave us instead the same inheritance, the same identity that Jesus had. The righteousness of God. Our call is to reconcile. Our call is to make peace. Our call is to forgive, to have mercy. Because when we extend mercy and we extend forgiveness, we are extending freedom. It says if we don't have the ability or the desire to do that, it's not terrible to not have a desire. Sometimes it sucks, but we're still called to it. Extend forgiveness. Extend mercy. It's a powerful thing. It brings forgiveness. In that first passage, we look forward. Jesus gives his mission statement. The Spirit of the Lord is upon you to proclaim good news to the poor and to give liberty to the captives, sight to the blind, and freedom to those who are in bondage, and to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. He gives that mission statement when he says to give freedom to those that were in bondage. He said liberty and freedom. They mean very similar or the same things. Liberty is to set free. To give freedom to those in bondage is to place in a position of freedom. Not just give it, not just offer it, but to place in a different spot that is freedom. This is a freedom zone, and you're placed into it. That's the salvation you came to bring. Real freedom. Real freedom. Really free. Real, real, free. Yes. It's real. If you don't experience it, there's more for you. We want to walk with you. Because freedom feels good. That's it. This is where we were made to exist. There's still bondage. There's still captivity. There's still blindness. God doesn't want those things for you. Just like a good dad who wants his child to see where he's going, he wants to give a second. He wants to set his children free. He wants to give them the freedom to go and explore and be who they were created to be. Brilliant, brilliant, brilliant stuff. In Matthew 18, where 70 times 7 comes from, well, I forgive my brother 7 times, no, I tell you, forgive him 70 times 7. Jesus goes on, he even gives a parable that compares what forgiveness and what the kingdom of heaven is like. Jesus talks in parables. And that's why Paul calls it the mystery of the gospel, because it is confusing. It's difficult to wrap your mind around sometimes. Proverbs says it's the glory of God to conceal things, but the glory of kings to search them out. Right? God doesn't hide himself from us, he hides himself for us, so that when we explore and dig in and find him, there is celebration with him.
Amen.
We found him. Yes, this is awesome. It's the concept that if I give you everything over to you, if I hand everything out to you, none of it really feels like you've, it's not valid. It's all free. But when you dig into something, study something, explore something, you start to find God you're into, right? You go on a journey, that's fun. You get to explore and take step by step by step, discovering things on your own. That's way more fun than watching a YouTube video that accelerates by 100 times and you get to the end. Oh, that's what I'm cool about. Now, the value is in the journey. The value is in the exploring. It's for God and his glory to conceal things, but it's for us as kings and queens to dig in and find them. So Jesus talks in parables for us, not to hide things from us. But here's one of the stories he gives to compare the kingdom of heaven. He says it may be compared to a king who wished to settle his accounts with his servants. Now when he began to settle, one who was brought to him owed him 10,000 talents. If you want a present day interpretation of 10,000 talents, this is about $6 billion. It's a lot of money. 10,000 talents. And since he could not pay, his master ordered him to be sold with his wife and children, and all that he had came to be made. See, this guy can't pay this back. Not to mention he's been living however many years of life under the $6 billion debt. There's no way that at any point the king can say, all right, I want to keep that. And you can't make much of a plan with a girl. You can't make much of a plan with your family, with your career. If you know at any point you can get locked up or sold into slavery forever, you don't have a lot of commitment to offer. This dude's living with a $6 billion debt. Wants to settle it. Okay, well then you and your wife and children, everything, your life right now, your death, nothing can satisfy this, so I'm taking all of it. Condemnation for everyone, everything, every bit of your life is condemned and sold. So the servant fell on his knees, imploring him, have patience with me, and I will pay you everything. No more. How much patience do you think this guy's got? How many hundreds of years do you think you have? You're not going to pay back his debt. $6 billion. But the king, out of pity for him, released him, forgave him the debt. When that servant went out, so this guy was forgiven for $6 billion. He said, hey, you know what? Never mind, I forgive you. Go ahead. Go live life. Go embrace freedom. No more debt. No more weight, dark cloud over your head. There's freedom for you. Go ahead. This servant, I don't know if he's still in shock or he just couldn't wrap his mind around what was just given to him, but this is how the story goes on. When that same servant went out, he found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii, which is maybe $10,000. Not quite $6 million. $10,000 for a second. When he found him owed $10,000, seizing him, he began to choke him, saying, pay what you owe. So his fellow servant fell down and pleaded with him, have patience with me and I will pay you. Sounds familiar. But this servant refused and went and put him in prison until he should pay the debt. Now when his fellow servant saw what had taken place, they were greatly distressed, and they went and reported to their master all that had just taken place. Then his master summoned that servant back and said to him, you wicked servant, I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me. And should you not have had mercy on your fellow servant as I had mercy on you? And in his anger, his master delivered him to the jailers until he should pay all his debt. So also my heavenly Father will do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother from your heart. He didn't understand what he has been forgiven of. I don't think because we understand the forgiveness that Jesus put on display for us. You can't help but be, I can't believe what I've been gifted. I can't believe the freedom I've been given. I have an eternity in hell waiting for me, that death could happen any moment. At any time I could die. And at any moment I could be condemned to hell forever. But instead, in his grace and his mercy and his love for you, he came and found you, woke you up from that death, gave you new life, a new identity, royal priesthood, ambassador for the king. You are son, you are daughter now. And if we wrap our minds around what that is, there's no way we would go to our fellow brothers and sisters entering into small fights compared to what he's done, especially, and not be able to forgive. Not be able to shed the same sort of forgiveness on them that we have been overwhelmed by. We're not able to show glimpses and pieces and pictures to those we come in contact with. Forgiveness is a call. It says, so also my heavenly Father will do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother from your heart. Man, forgiveness is huge, guys. And did you notice that the freedom that he did not offer, he had to throw in jail, the forgiveness that he did not offer, did you see where it put him? In the end, who ended up in prison? Who ended up with the jailer? The dude who didn't forgive. He was the one that got put in prison. When we withhold forgiveness, we're not throwing those who we're withholding forgiveness from in jail. It doesn't work that way. What you're doing is you're putting yourself in prison and captivity. You're giving them a hold over you that no one should have. You withhold forgiveness, you're drinking poison of bitterness, and it's going to take root, and the fruit in your life is going to bear out that poisonous, bitter, unforgiving fruit. When you forgive someone, it's not just granting them freedom the way that we were granted freedom. It gives us further steps into the gift of freedom that Jesus gave to us. We get to go deeper and deeper into freedom, deeper and deeper into salvation, deeper and deeper into what sanctification, righteous living, holy living looks like when we offer forgiveness because it sets us free. You withhold forgiveness, you say, you don't know what they did to me. It's putting yourself in prison.
Right.
And it's fair to say, it's fair for you to say to me, you don't know what they did. Fair, I don't. And I can't empathize. I can try my best, but I can never relate or fully understand what terrible, tragic things are represented in this room. Nobody. Absolutely not. Jesus can. Jesus walked out this life, the chosen people of God, putting him to death on the cross. After living perfectly, loving boldly, healing their sick, casting out their demons, feeding them, serving them, leading them into the kingdom, put to death on a cross, whipped, carries his own cross, put on it. On the cross, he speaks, Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing. Perfect love, perfect forgiveness. Jesus knows betrayal. He created this whole thing.
Right.
He created the entire planet. He knew every single human before any human was even thought of, before the foundations of the earth. Jesus knew the plan.
Right.
Standing outside of time, he looked into it, experienced it any way he wanted. He entered himself into it with the limitations of manhood on him, lived it out perfectly, was put to death, and offered forgiveness in the least forgiving opportunity. So you can, I don't know. I have no idea what's happening in your life. Many of your deepest, darkest, most painful things, I have no right to speak into. You need to forgive them. And I'm not saying you need to forgive them. I'm just reading you scripture that says forgiveness brings freedom to everybody. It's the way we are ambassadors. It's the way we look like our dad is when we offer freedom and forgiveness to the worst people, to our enemies, it says. That Christ died for them while we were still his enemies. Christ gave his life for us. Christ died for the sinner. Christ died for people who will never believe in him, that will never turn around and stop betraying him, their creator. He died for them and says, I forgive them. I want them to be a part of my family. God, I want us to get that so much that he gave to us, what the forgiveness that he laid out. Because it wasn't just the mercy, it just wasn't the forgiveness, it's that grace and that gifting above and beyond mercy, he gave us the gift of grace, a new identity, come into my family, be my son and my daughter, not my enemy, my offspring. Not the sinner that people say you are, even like you feel you might are. I don't want your identity to be found. I am a sinner saved by grace. Thank God, but I'm a sinner. I'm not even worth it. Yeah, you are. Jesus died for you. Jesus wanted you. He gave his life. He gave everything up so he could have you in his family. You are worth it. You've been given a new identity. That Jesus has been, he went to everything to get you. God says, now you're my son, my daughter. I love you. You wear my clothes. You're in my kingdom. You're in my house. You are worth it. You are no longer a sinner. You are a son. You can choose to live into your old identity if you want, but Scripture says the old is gone. That the new has come. The old has passed away. Separated our sins as far as the east is from the west. The forgiveness, the liberty word in his mission statement, bring liberty to the captives, that sort of forgiveness and freedom he's offering, it's as if you never knew what you were held captive for in the first place. It's gone. It's for God. Oh my gosh, it's so good. I felt this morning when I was putting some of this together to offer a couple things just as far as freedom goes and the practical side of our forgiveness. The practical side of forgiveness, just offering up a little bit of practical stuff with it. I think it can be misconstrued and misrepresented what forgiveness is and what forgiveness is not. Right? Because forgiveness is powerful, forgiveness is divine. But there's a lot of emotions, there's a lot of feeling, there's a lot of experiences that need to be defined and communicated a little more gently and with a little more information, I think. First, forgiveness is not approving or denying that sin or wrongdoing happened. It's not approving sin, it's not denying the wrongdoing. Forgiveness doesn't mean justice can't be served, because tendency says, if I forgive them, then there's no justice that will be served. If I forgive them, I'm letting them off the hook. God makes it very clear in Scripture that justice is mine. You forgive, I have the justice. Everyone one day will stand before the throne of God. He will hand it. You forgive. It's not approving of the sin. It's not denying that wrongdoing happened. But justice is not our responsibility. God will hand it for you in this day or the next day. Forgiveness is rarely a one-time event. It's a process. Forgiving doesn't mean you don't feel the pain anymore. Forgiveness is not forgetting what happened. Right? Forgiveness isn't saying that this never happened, or I forgot, I'm going to forgive and forget. It doesn't work. Forgiveness isn't saying that it doesn't hurt anymore, and forgiveness is a process. Process is step by step. For some people, it's every single day waking up and forgiving those who have betrayed them, abandoned them, hurt them, abused them. Every single day, it's a forgiveness process we have to walk through. And forgiveness doesn't mean that that doesn't hurt every single day. Attention. The only way to turn that pain off, the only way to turn that hurt off, is to turn everything off. Don't do that. Don't turn off all emotion, because it will cancel out the joy and the love and the opportunity and real relationships along with it.
That's right.
You put a wall that's built so heavy and strong around you that no good thing can get in just because you don't want the bad stuff to get out. Pain is okay. It needs to be processed. It needs to be walked through. Forgiving is not forgetting. It's not opening up the opportunity for you to be hurt again. And don't forgive and forget and then put yourself in the same scenario and be hurt all over again. Absolutely not. That is not what forgiveness is. The last one I'm going to say is that forgiveness is waiting for an apology.
Right.
That's tough. But the person that you need to forgive doesn't the person need to say, I'm sorry. You can forgive anyone and everyone without an apology. And you need to. It's going to set you free. Again, that's what forgiveness does. It offers them the gift of freedom. It sets you free from the bitterness and the unforgiveness. And walking in that freedom is the way that God wants you to walk. Dealing with it, processing it, all part of it, necessary parts of it. But forgiveness comes from you.
Right.
You can't control other people at all. You can barely control yourself. Right? That's why self-control is all qualifications of elements. Fruits of the Spirit. Spirit forgiveness on self-control. Self-control is a consistent theme in the scripture because that's difficult. And if you've got that, you can pretty much do anything you want. Congratulations, you control the hardest thing. You love trying to control other people. You can dictate forgiveness. Your love is not dependent on other people's behalf. Love comes from the Father, which is always perfect, always enough, always deeper. And that love is where I find my inspiration, my capability to pour love out on those that come around me. And other people's behavior isn't going to sway this to me. You don't get that sort of influence in my life. You get to influence my emotions or how I feel, how badly or how good I am in the day-to-day walk of my life. No, that's between me and him. And the way that I love can't be affected by the way you behave.
Right.
That applies specifically to forgiving. Blessed are you, the day you show mercy. Forgive us the way we have forgiven those who sin against us. We are ambassadors to reconciliation. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will look like their day. It's one of my favorite texts. I want to make peace. Because today is the day to do it. Don't walk out of here, because I just laid out a lot of scripture. I probably went a little bit too long, but I laid out a lot of stuff as it relates to forgiveness. The best day to do it is today. Withholding forgiveness, we talked about, it's like drinking a bitter poison. It takes seed, and it takes root, and it produces fruit that you don't want to have in your life. So I'm going to encourage you. Offer forgiveness today. Again, it doesn't mean they didn't do something wrong. It doesn't mean that you're approving what they did. They don't need to apologize. And it doesn't mean you won't set healthy boundaries in your life. Boundaries are key to healthy relationships. Please, please, we are going to have people that are up here to minister to you, to pray for you, to talk with you. Begin the process of forgiveness. That is what's going to lead to freedom. Real, real freedom. Fun, freedom. Joy-filled peace that can't be taken away. Freedom. God, I want to thank you over and over again for mercy, the forgiveness, the supernatural grace you've lavished on my life. The way that you've taken the grossness, selfishness, pride from my past and redeemed it into something completely of you. God, there are so many people in this room that are pure evidence of your God, your grace, and your mercy. Thank you so, so much that you redeemed so many. Jesus, I pray today that you would begin to soften those places of our hearts where we are withholding forgiveness. And God, that as we offer forgiveness, the first step is just saying that we forgive them. Just allowing that to even be a possibility in our life, that forgiveness can be extended. It doesn't even need to be communicated. Eventually, the freedom that you offer through personal, communicated forgiveness is new freedom, God. But God, let's start that process today. Don't let us be content with the bitter and chains and captivity. Don't let us be content with just a little bit of freedom, or sometimes I feel free, but God, let us enter into pure, all the time, all the way freedom. Let us forgive without needing an apology. Let us forgive without feeling like we're justifying behavior. God, let us forgive and to continue to dig into what it means to do this in a healthy way. God, forgiveness is just one element of this love that is radical. This love that is counter-cultural. This love that can be abrasive and difficult and enters into the difficult situations to make peace. Give us a deeper understanding of your love, Jesus. And Not the love that we so often advocate for here in culture, but the love that really ended up entering you into such a conflict that it ended your life. The love is difficult and messy, but God, we want to step into it with boldness. God, give us health. Give us wisdom. Give us discernment. Pour it out on us. Spirit, come alive and take our thoughts. Darkness has no place here. We are the lights of the world. For both in the house and outside of the house, we are lights. So God, shine your light here in each person's soul, each person's heart. Reveal the dark corners that they've wanted to captivate in. Reveal the broken pieces and the captive pieces of people's hearts that haven't been exposed to the light in a long time. May your love and your spirit flood into people's inner walk with you and reveal those broken spots. The parts where we refuse to forgive and refuse to love, refuse to offer mercy. God, let us be a supernatural people that offers real freedom. Let us follow closely and step with you, Jesus, to understand and to recognize that you showed us the perfect example. We're hungry for it, God. We're hungry for it. We love you, Jesus. We want to be like you, Jesus. Thank you for an identity that says we're yours and we are victorious, we are free, we are redeemed and reconciled perfectly to you. Thank you for that, God. That is ours. Continue to sanctify us towards your righteousness. Continue to draw us into the holiest places with you. Continue to let us step out of our comfort zones so we can be comforted by the Comforter. We love you. We love you, Jesus. Reveal our hearts, and God, may this be a time where we can be vulnerable, where we can be sincere. God, the ministry team, as they come up, give them the words and the discernment, the wisdom to talk with people, and to pass people along when it's outside of their comfort zone, their understanding ability. But God, may people gain freedom today. More than anything, God, give freedom, and God, may your presence be here dwelling with us in this time of ministry. We love you. We bless your name. We pray this thing in your precious name, Jesus. Amen. Right now, we're in the time of ministry. Ministry team, you come up. They want to change.
Stand up. Like always, we always want to lead out the Holy Spirit opportunity to touch people, to minister to people. And we have a ministry team that's here. It's available. Healing, deliverance, breakthrough. For someone just coming to agree with you about something you're trusting God for, or specifically today on forgiveness. And there may be someone that you just need to just come and just be transparent with, someone that you just, sometimes we just got to get things out into the light. We just got to talk about it and just release it as we tell it to someone. Get it out in the light. One of the things the enemy will do his best with forgiveness is to try to keep things in the dark. The enemy, listen, Satan is bound to darkness. He can't come into the light. And if he can whisper a lie of deception, if he can whisper a lie that will keep you into bondage, you'll stay in the darkness by not exposing him to the light. Verbal communication with someone, you'll keep you in bondage. You'll hold on to him. But he knows once you start walking towards the light, his fear is he knows he can't go there, so he has to let you go as you walk into the light, because he's bound to darkness. I just had a sense while Nick was praying that there's a number of folk in here, but the person that your heart learned unforgiveness against is dead, not even around. They've been dead for years. You still have a wound, you still have the unforgiveness towards that particular person. Today could be the day that you begin to move towards that freedom. Remember, forgiveness is a choice. It's not a one-time event. 70 times 7 is 490 times. If it pops up in your thought like 490 times a day, you make the choice releasing that person. The feelings may not change right away, but you make the choice. And walking and moving towards ultimate culmination of that is set free. The point of where you think that you can see that person without the angry emotions coming up. That's the place we want to get to. stop you. Let the enemy whisper to you in your ear. You're the person that the Holy Spirit's nudging on. Okay? Father, I just speak a blessing over each person. Speak life over each person. Holy Spirit, we just turn you loose to do whatever you have to do. Nudge and pull forward. We love you, sir. We honor your presence. We thank you for what you're doing this morning. In Jesus' name. Amen. You're free to go. You want to come and talk to somebody on the ministry team? Please come to my house.